What's up, everybody? This is Kevin with the Burgundy Brigade. Got another video here for you. Now, the Colorado Avalanche have been having a challenging season, and one key to turning it around will be their power play, which is not doing so great right now. Now, the stark difference between this year's power play and last year's power play, and I'm going to break down a few things of what they are doing very well a season ago versus what they aren't doing this season. So the first power play we're going to look at is versus the Phoenix Coyotes from last season when they actually were still called Phoenix. So you're going to see a lot of things go right. First off, Ryan O'Reilly wins the faceoff and the power play starts itself right up. First thing to note is that the penalty kill. Every penalty kill has the same goal. Try and force the power play to keep the puck and their chances to the outside away from the most dangerous areas in the slot right in front of the net. Now the power play is at a huge advantage because everywhere they go, they should have multiple options to multiple options with the puck. Now as we see, PA Parenteau has three strong options. What ends up creating the best chance, and you'll see this in the action here, isn't the passing, but it's the movement of the players away from the puck. So what happens here is Parenteau passes down to Matt Duchene on the right wing. Ryan O'Reilly will shift from in front of the net to the side of the net. Jamie McGinn will make himself dangerous in the threat right in the middle of the slot, and Nick Holden will start to crash the net on the back side. Now Duchene has the puck, and again we see his options. Now Duchene, being a smart player, sees the upcoming chance with Holden on the back side, but knows he isn't the best guy to make the pass. Ryan O'Reilly also sees this, and we get some quick passing that results in a quick opportunity and a good save from Phoenix's goalie. Parenteau does a good job keeping the puck in, and again we see a lot of options with him. I'm going to let this run a little bit, but note that the Phoenix's players have a tough time getting set because the Avs, without the puck, are constantly in motion. They do get a clear, but we'll eventually see the Avs get set up again. So the Avs are bringing the puck back into the zone. This is going to run for a little bit longer. And once it stops, we'll show you once again. Here it comes back to the point. And again, options. We see the options. But again, what happens here is the danger is going to start to ramp up because the puck comes down to Ryan O'Reilly. And he has three options that are all dangerous. Again, he's thinking a few steps ahead. Notices that there is a big open space at the top. And not to mention, there are two penalty-killing forwards with their backs turned to the point. Now, he again knows that he's not the best guy to make this pass. He also sees that Matt Duchene is over there. Matt Duchene sees the play as well. Duchene gets the puck, sets up Parenteau for an easy one-timer. Everybody down low drives the net and creates havoc. Goalie never gets a clear view of the shot. Avs notch a power play goal. Lots of good things happening on that power play. And now we're going to look at a contrasting power play from this season that shows a distinct lack of these principles. Now this power play is from just a few weeks ago when the Avalanche played against Detroit. And this illustrates the big thing that's missing from the Avalanche power play this season, and that is the movement away from the puck. Again, the Avs win the faceoff, and we see the penalty killing unit forming their diamond or their box to keep the play to the outside. We do see the little cycle start between Nate MacKinnon and Matt Duchene, but the other thing we see is two defensemen at the point standing completely still. Max Talbot goes and stands in front of the net, but doesn't really do anything else. No one's really moving away from the puck to create options. MacKinnon does make a nice feed up to Eric Johnson, but again, from here, nothing really happens. I do want to illustrate with this, what should happen. Now, much of the movement away from the puck on power plays is decided by the action of the player with the puck, in this case, Eric Johnson. What I would like to see him do here is make himself more of a threat to shoot by moving to the center of the ice. This would cause Brad Stewart to rotate down, be a threat for a one-timer. Max Talbot should rotate from in front of the net to the left wing to be an outlet. Nathan MacKinnon should rotate into the slot for a tip or slap pass opportunity. Matt Duchene would rotate to MacKinnon's previous location in the low faceoff circle, and this would create all of the options and force the penalty kill unit to stand still to see what's going to happen. It forces the penalty kill to be reactionary instead of being able to force the play because they don't know where the puck is going. Instead, what do we see? Nothing. Everybody stands still. Eric Johnson is limited in his options. He can go across, try a shot, or force a pass. In this case, he chose to make an unadvised pass through several bodies, misses his intended man, and the Red Wings are able to not only clear, but actually get a scoring opportunity while shorthanded. The Avalanche are never really able to get the power play set up again, and 2 minutes of an advantage are totally wasted. Now, another thing from a season ago that actually worked very much in the favor of the Avalanche power play was their set plays. Both power play units had a play that they would always go back to in order to create their options. And the best thing about them was that there was always movement away from the puck. Illustrated in this game versus the New York Rangers from a season ago, the Avs will win the faceoff and go straight into their set play. Tyson Barrie moves to the center of the zone, making him a threat to shoot. Paul Stastny comes up the left wing to be an option. Nathan MacKinnon goes and stands directly to the side of the net. Gabe Landeskog stays in the slot, and Andre Benoit rotates and eventually crashes the backside of the net. Stastny wins the faceoff, everything springs into motion, and we see our set play. Barrie passes back to Paul Stastny, who will fake a shot, and this commands the attention of the near defenseman. The pass then goes down low to Nathan MacKinnon, who is presented with several options, all of them dangerous. Stastny, Landeskog, and Benoit all start to move towards the net, allowing MacKinnon to find any of these three, take the shot himself, or rotate off and find relief from Tyson Barrie. In this case, it's a pass right to Gabe Landeskog in the middle with a quick one-timer in the low slot to beat Henrik Lundqvist. Taking advantage of options from good passing and movement away from the puck, forcing the penalty kill to choose something to react to, and taking advantage of the chance they give you. The MSG replay actually shows a great angle from above, and you'll see that in just a second. And you can just see everything move as if you're watching from right above. The set play from the other unit all ran through Matt Duchene and Ryan O'Reilly. We saw it all last season, but this example from Game 7 of the Avs versus Wild series really showed it working about as well as it ever did all year. Matt Duchene and Ryan O'Reilly have this perfect little cycle game that they run. They look over their options, and if nothing is there, the pass goes down low, the two trade spots, and the process repeats itself. Again, the key to most of this is movement away from the puck. Parenteau, McGinn, Holden, all constantly moving to make themselves a threat. And I'm going to let the power play develop a little here as we watch the cycle game go between O'Reilly and Duchene. Movement back and forth, and eventually here, Matt Duchene will come up and find P.A. Parenteau at the top of the point. Now the options continue here because the Wild have three penalty killers above the face-off circles and only one down low. Parenteau gets a shot, the Wild overreact, and the Avs actually end up with a great chance right there. We're going to let it develop again, and again you'll see them regain possession of the puck, and then again we'll go right back into their set play. Duchene and O'Reilly will start their cycle again, only this time when Duchene gets the puck, he's going to make a change of pace. The Wild are expecting one thing, but Duchene gets the puck, goes for a quick jam, everybody overreacts, and the puck ends up in the back of their net. Complete disarray from the Wild penalty kill, costing them in the end. Now, of course, my favorite part of that end of that one is watching Ryan Suter go and complain to the referee because Nick Holden ended up knocking him down, but that's just me. Nonetheless, the power play last season, again, all of the movement, all of the set plays, created excellent opportunities, and we see it again here on the replay as it comes down low. Duchene makes a quick move, everybody tries to do something, but nobody ends up being able to do anything. Now, the last power play that we're going to show is probably the worst power play the Avalanche have had this season. It was a 5-on-3 advantage against Chicago not too long ago. When the Avs win the faceoff, everybody moves into their spots, and with a 5-on-3 advantage, you've got to have movement. You've got all of the advantage. You have to keep the confusion, but note all five Avalanche players and where they are standing and see how little movement there is. No movement, no confusion, some passing. It's absolutely no wonder to see that the Blackhawks are able to get the puck cleared before too long. Letting it run a little bit, you'll see the Avs will gain possession and get it back in the zone, but again, the Blackhawks are able to be aggressive because the Avs are not moving. This will allow Jonathan Toews to get the puck out again. And the Avs will only get one shot on goal in this whole time, a one-timer with little to no traffic in front that is easily stopped and held onto. Possibly the worst power play of the season, but a perfect example of the difference between this season's power play and last season's power play. The Avs have got a lot more movement going.